In his day, Soapy Smith was more well-known than Wyatt Earp. Bat Masterson, well, he counted Jeff Smith amongst his friends. A prospector named Mont Hawthorne described Soapy Smith this way. Soapy was a nice mannered, clean-looking fella. He never went around talking and bragging and shoving folks. He moved quiet and soft-like, but he was always figuring out how things was best for Soapy every minute. Jefferson Randolph Smith was born into a well-to-do Georgia family of ministers and lawyers. The Smith family's wealth was in land and slaves, and during the Civil War and the tumultuous Reconstruction period, the family lost everything. Jefferson's father was a lawyer who abandoned his practice and turned to alcohol. He moved the family to Round Rock, Texas, and according to historical accounts, that was the extent of the father's efforts on behalf of his family. Jefferson's mother operated a wood-framed hotel in Round Rock, which was a whistle stop on the railroad. It is believed that Jeff Smith's first job was working for his mother as a steerer to her hotel. Young Jeff Smith would meet weary travelers at the station and extol the virtues of his mother's business. According to historians, Smith learned much from the itinerant street peddlers of Round Rock. He learned their patter, and he learned their sleight-of-hand tricks.
There's two things that strike me as significant about Jefferson and Soapy Smith. The first of all is his Southern background. This is very typical of a lot of Western outlaws. After the Civil War, the Southern economy was wrecked, and Soapy Smith, his family came from Denton, Georgia, I believe, they had nothing. So they struck out for Texas to try to rebuild. So many Southern communities and families in the wake of the war, there was no economy, nothing to kind of sustain themselves. And so they tried to make a go out of it, and they did so by moving west. And you have the same kinds of phenomena. Soapy Smith was very young, obviously, but the same kinds of phenomena were typical for the former Confederate soldiers. And you had a lot of former Confederate soldiers who would migrate westward and participate in basically creating organized criminal activities. This is all throughout Arizona, all throughout Colorado, Montana, Idaho. It's just filled with ex-Confederates kind of replaying the Civil War, waging campaigns against against the law. So that I think is one way in which this sort of fits into a larger historical pattern. Southerners migrating to the mineral frontier in the American West and wreaking havoc.
A teenage Jeff Smith drove cattle. This work eventually took him and his friend Joe Simmons to Abilene, Kansas. It is generally accepted by historians that Smith ran into a circus there and the circus grifter. Smith lost a large sum of money to this circus grifter named Clubfoot Hall in the old pea and shell game. Smith, it is said, begged Clubfoot Hall to be taken on as an apprentice, and apparently Hall agreed. After some time as Hall's shill, Smith found his own circus to run with. Smith is said to have worked as a circus grifter until 1877, when he got the news that Leadville, Colorado was in the midst of a silver boom. When 18-year-old Jeff Smith arrived in Leadville, he was still performing the walnut shell and dry pecan. He must have been impressed when he ran in a serious competition in the form of an old man and some bars of soap. V. Bullock Old Man Taylor is widely credited as being the originator of the soap kind that would figure so prominently in Jeff Smith's life and his place in Western lore. Old Man Taylor agreed to take Jeff Smith on as an apprentice, and again, Smith started out as a shill. Soon afterward, Jeff Smith is said to have moved on to his own street corner, playing a new game, the soap con. By 1879, Leadville had become civilized. Leadville was once a hard scrabble mining town. Now it had opera houses and classy hotels. And besides, everyone had been fleeced once, and no one was a stranger to anyone anymore. The town was drying up for the con man. Jeff Smith and Old Man Taylor headed in different directions. Old Man Taylor headed east. Jeff Smith, he headed down the mountain toward Denver. Jeff Smith was not yet 21 years old when he arrived in Denver. Thousands of people, men mostly, arrived in Denver and disembarked from the main train lines before boarding the smaller train lines and stagecoaches, which would then carry them to the mountainous mining camps. Lower downtown Denver, today popularly known as Lodo, was filled with dance halls, gambling establishments, saloons, and bordellos. The police, as was common practice in many frontier boom towns, tolerated Denver's criminal element, making the city a place tailor-made for fledgling organized gangs. Denver was just a place for a young Jeff Smith. Historical arrest records and newspaper accounts show that the young Jeff Smith was not afraid of resorting to petty crime, and he was arrested a number of times for violent assaults. There is one arrest not found in 19th century newspapers, the arrest that led to his being nicknamed Soapy. Jeff Smith was arrested for selling soap without a license. The arresting officer listed the defendant's name in the police register as Soapy Smith, thus conferring on Jeff Smith what would become his famous moniker, Soapy Smith. Basically, the Soap Con is a rigged lottery designed to run circles around gambling laws by offering for sale a legitimate product, and well, the prospector might just get lucky too. After all, surprise gifts inside the packaging were the rage during this time period. Soapy Smith generally set up his tripe and keister on 17th Street, just a few blocks from the Union train station. He pulled up in a wagon and began the visually elaborate sure thing ceremony, wrapping his bars of Wonder Soap in blue paper. This was the golden age of the orator, and Soapy was fully aware of how important the proper oration was to a sure thing con. One of the interesting aspects of the Soap Con was that the marks were sure they saw the money actually put in those wrappers. They were sure it was there. This was an era where surprise gifts and the like were all the rage in packaging. Gentlemen, the all-important question which I propound to you and for which I earnestly seek the answer is this. How are you fixed for soap? But seriously, though my message is that of soap, it is likewise a message of hope. For today, to meet that need which is so apparent in you, I bring a new soap, a Wonder Soap. Here is the finest cleansing product ever brought forth by men's scientific ingenuity, the fruit of many weary months of patient research and experiment in my own laboratories. Use this soap upon your skin, and it will shine like the moon, and your face will gleam with the radiance of the sun at noonday. Soapy presented an excellent show with his sleight-of-hand performance, and he always attracted a crowd, often of 200 or 300, said contemporary W.P. Sersenfern in an early 20th century Trail magazine article. The show went on for 2 or 3 hours, and he took in sometimes $200 to $300. After a day of fleecing the overly hopeful crowds, Soapy Smith pocketed his earnings and headed over to Denver's Arcade, a gaming house of some historical note. It was usually here that Soapy would lose it all at the faro table. According to one historian, Soapy Smith lost more money at the faro table than any other man in Denver history, and old-time gamblers never disputed the claim. Soapy Smith formed a number of important relationships during this first Denver stint. It was here that Soapy met and married his wife, with whom he had 5 children. By all accounts, Smith took care of the family financially. He bought his wife a house in a part of Denver far away from the rough-and-tumble and hard-scrabble life of Denver's Lodo. Mrs. Smith generally associated with the women of Denver's business class, all the while holding herself out as the wife of a local Denver businessman. Soapy Smith had an enemy, however, who exposed Mrs. Smith as Soapy Smith's wife. The enemy was a local newspaper editor for the city's Rocky Mountain News. His name was John Arkins, a muckraking journalist who was at war with Denver's criminal class. Editor Arkins' efforts had already gotten Soapy's goat, so to speak. This outing of Smith's wife and subsequent social ostracization caused her enraged Soapy Smith and caused him to lose his temper. Smith vowed revenge, and it did not take long for him to act on the vow. Soapy Smith waited for Editor Arkins outside the paper's offices, and when Arkins arrived one day, Soapy severely beat Arkins with a walking stick. The local prosecutor wanted to charge Soapy with attempted murder, but the charge was reduced to assault, and for whatever reasons, Smith was never brought to trial. After the well-publicized assault incident and the loss of her societal status, which must have been quite comfortable, Miss Smith took the children and moved to St. Louis. Editor Arkins turned up the heat on Soapy and his gang, running articles that detailed the gang's illegal efforts. Denver had grown hot. It was time to move on. Soapy Smith returned briefly to Denver in the spring of 1891, satisfied that the coast was again clear and that the efforts at reform had played themselves out. Soapy reopened his Tivoli Saloon gambling hall. It wasn't long, however, until news of another silver boom reached Denver. This time the boom was in not so far away Cree, Colorado. Soapy left the Tivoli in the Reverend Bower's hands and headed to Creed. When he arrived in Creed, however, Smith would find that Creed already had an infamous resident in control of its underworld, the notorious low-down coward Bob Ford. Ford was well known and despised for killing Jesse James. Bob Ford operated out of a place named, logically enough, Ford's Exchange, which was a typical boomtown saloon gambling hall and bordello, and Ford had percentages of all the action, including the pea and walnut shell games out in the streets. Soapy concentrated on the structure of the town and managed to install his hand-picked businessmen on the town council and his brother-in-law, the chief of police. It was during the Creed stint that Soapy's old friend from the trail, Joe Simmons, caught pneumonia and died. This was a strong friendship that has been immortalized in poem and song. Simmons' death is known to have affected Soapy Smith greatly. By the end of 1892, Soapy had worn out his Creed welcome. A group of so-called law-abiding citizens visited Smith and announced their intentions to install a legitimate government. Soapy did not care about Creed. He did not have a big enough piece of the place to care. He planned his departure, but not before one incident of note. A man named Ed O'Kelly, who for some reason was looking to avenge the death of Jesse James, had shown up in Creed, looking for Bob Ford. And it did not take long for O'Kelly to find Ford. Overestimating the populace's ability to recognize poetic justice, Kelly thought it a good idea to shoot Ford in the back. The old West was beginning to die one piece at a time. Smith quietly boarded a train back to Denver and forgot about Creed altogether. Soapy returned to Denver in the summer of 1892, reopening the Tivoli Saloon, and he went back to the low-low street corners to hawk his famous soap. Soapy probably resolved to stay in Denver for a few years, but something happened in the USA silver mining industry during this Denver period. Silver lost its grip on the USA. Then the Depression of 1893 hit. Soapy's relationship with the Denver police had by now grown more strained. Soapy again got himself into trouble with his temper. He was arrested for assaulting a police officer after gang member George Wilder was accused of steering a mark toward a crooked poker game. 3 months later, four more of Soapy's steerers were in the Denver jail, including the Reverend Bowers. Soapy was able to secure their release on the condition that they leave Denver. From the years 1893 to 1897, it's difficult to establish a full count of how and where Soapy Smith and his gang spent their time, but history can piece together a rough chronology. Smith tried establishing his corrupt organization in Spokane, Pocatello, Cheyenne, Colorado Springs, Salt Lake City, and Ogden. Nothing appears to have taken hold in those places. He was arrested for vagrancy in St. Louis. Smith ended up in El Paso, Texas, where he cooked up an ill-fated but ambitious and imaginative scheme. One of those mother-of-all-cons type of things. Smith got word that the Mexican president was having trouble finding soldiers that he needed to help him defend his second term. Smith assumed the title colonel and traveled to Mexico, where he was able to arrange a meeting with President Porfirio Diaz. During the meeting, Soapy made his pitch. All he needed was $10,000 in cash, just enough to equip the army, and he, Colonel Smith, would be able to raise the troops. Diaz either did not have the cash on hand or wisely claimed not to have the money. Soapy Smith left Mexico empty-handed but hopeful. The con fell apart while Colonel Smith was back in the U.S. Suspicious Mexican officials checked on Smith's story and immediately discovered the bogus title and put an end to this particular Soapy Smith con. In early 1896, Soapy Smith attempted to set up shop in Cripple Creek, Colorado, but was met at the train station by a hired gun employed by city officials. The hired gun convinced Smith to stay on board the train and continue onward. Soapy returned to Denver by default. By most accounts, he was despondent, but it would not take long for the news of a big strike to hit town. The discovery of gold in the Klondike clearly appeared to be a boon to Soapy and his gang. This was a gold rush on steroids, and Soapy was going to get there first, unlike back in Creed, where Bob Ford beat him to it. Colonel Jeff R. Smith, the Reverend Bowers, and Dr. W.H. Jackson have declared their intentions to go to Japan. They announced their object as a pleasure and sightseeing trip, but judging from the props they were seen carrying, they intend to be prepared for emergencies. A few days later, the Denver Times printed the real story on July 22nd. The source was a letter Soapy had written to a friend in confidence. The contents of the letter were leaked. "Call out the troops," the Times wrote. "Colonel Jefferson Smith is going to the Klondike." Claim jumpers had already arrived in Skagway, and they arrested Captain Bill and Moore's claims from him. The newly appointed city engineer, Frank Reid, he laid out lots in the mountain flank delta. The town site was laid out by Reid, who was a former county official from the Puget Sound country. The town was divided into blocks and parceled out among the 200 arrivals. Captain Moore was apparently offered a lot, which he refused. A number of men took away his cabin and dumped it on the tide flats. By mid-August, U.S. Commissioner John U. Smith and surveyor Frank Reid began surveying lots and recording titles, charging $5 a lot. Members of the self-appointed town council sold 1,100 of Bill and Moore's lots in 2 days. Soapy and at least some of the gang arrived in Skagway in mid-August. The town was just getting up and going. The main thoroughfare and business district was a mud-strewn tent city called Broadway. Upon his arrival, Soapy spotted Clancy's Saloon. Clancy agreed to partner up with Soapy Smith, and Smith began running gang operations out of Clancy's. Immediately, Soapy Smith had a share of the town's prostitution racket. Smith and his gang quickly started shaking down business owners by offering protection services, which of course meant that upon proper and timely payments, Soapy's thugs would leave a business alone and shield such businesses from other thugs attempts to do the same thing.
The cons are great. They had some absolutely magnificent, very diversified cons, and I think this is also what makes Soapy Smith such a fascinating entrepreneur in so many ways. Because in Skagway, he managed basically to create an entire apparatus of fraud. All of these different kind of shops and offices. The town was crawling with people who worked for him, people who, you know, got a small cut of whatever they managed to take in. So it was a complex operation that in many ways mirrors the kind of corporate expansion of that period. You have the growth of big business, and here is someone who managed to, if you will, kind of horizontally integrate all of the fraud possibilities in Skagway. So among those, you had, of course, the saloons, which were, I think, really kind of the centerpiece of this, you know, getting people to sort of willfully gamble away all their money. But then you had the other operations that preyed on the transitory nature of Skagway itself as the launching pad for so many people going up into the Yukon looking for gold. These were people who did not want to stick around for long. It was against their financial interest to stick around for long. So even if they got ripped off, they tended, you know, they're, of course, there was no real representative of the law to appeal to, but it also was just not in their interest to stick around. So when you have a situation where you've got newcomers entering into Skagway, you know, they don't, you know, they've been on these long trips. It's taken a great effort for them to get where they need to be. They want to let their families know that they're okay, and here you have someone offering to send a telegraph for $5 from the city, of course, that had no telegraph lines, but people didn't know that. So you're willing to pay $5 to alert your family that you're okay. You know, these are guys who would pay that and then, you know, sort of trudge out of town. Or if they happen to stick around, they might, you know, get a message the next day saying, hey, we've got a reply, you need to come back to the office and you know, for another couple of bucks, we will get your message to you. When they get back to the office, the proprietor of the telegraph office gets a message from his wife that he has, you know, he's needed back at his camp. He leaves, the gamblers kind of move in, and pretty soon the fellows stripped bare.
By October 1897, Soapy Smith's gang had established Jeff Smith's Parlor Bar and moved their principal operations to that location. There was no law. The only representative of the federal government was an official known under the imposing title of Deputy U.S. Marshal. He was in fact in league with the criminal element, who, though numerous, were in the minority. They had the advantage of being thoroughly organized and armed and skillfully led by a man named Soapy Smith, who was the uncrowned king of Skagway. He was not a constitutional monarch, but his word was all the law there was in Skagway, as quoted in S.H. Graves, president of the White Pass and Yukon Route. Officers from the steamship No-Yo from Skagway today reported conditions of lawlessness at Skagway as beyond control. Law-abiding people do not dare say a word against them. Hold-ups, robberies, and shootings are part of a daily routine. 8 dead bodies were picked up on White Pass on February 15. Merchants and businessmen, hungry for the lavish patronage of the gang of rogues, aided and abetted. There was a reign of terror. Honest men were intimidated. The people were cowed. It was Smith gang policy to prey upon transients. As for the residents of the town who let the gang be, those residents were generally left alone, and no doubt many of them were probably loyal customers at the saloon and the crib. The so-called better element became callous and submissive. infinitely better than a man who is such an infant as to try to beat a man at his own game should lose money here at the seaport, than he should try to get into the inhospitable Arctic where such an idiot would lose it anyway, and there become a burden on the community, Soapy used to say. I knew Soapy personally and was proud of it, but as I had no money and knew enough to keep my mouth shut, I was absolutely safe. He was a bad man, but he wasn't as bad as his gang, who would stop at nothing. Arthur T. Walden.
Soapy Smith is a remora. He's able to do this for a very short period of time. He moves into a community, attaches himself to it by drawing a distinction between insiders and outsiders. It's only the outsiders who are the targets of the scam. So he manages for a very short period of time to get communities to basically look the other way. They're profiting from it in some sense because people are just automatic, they're all coming through. Soapy Smith presents himself as kind of a philanthropist for the communities. He claims disingenuously that he's doing a moral favor to the communities by teaching people that they can't win. So he's always presenting himself as sort of a blessing to these communities, but in time they all turn against him.
Prospector named Andy McGrath and an unidentified woman went to the Klondike Saloon for a drink. McGrath stated that his liquor had been doped and he was robbed of $140. This accusation provoked a fight in which McGrath was badly beaten by a bartender named Faye. Faye was assisted by thugs associated with the saloon, probably gang members. McGrath wanted revenge. He burst out into the street. His plan was to obtain a gun and go back inside to use it to finish the fight. The first person he met was a U.S. Marshal named Rowan. Rowan agreed to go to the establishment and act as a peacemaker. When the two men entered, McGrath struck Fay. Fay drew his revolver and shot McGrath in the groin. Marshal Rowan turned to pull his revolver, and he too was shot by Bartender Fay. Bartender Fay, realizing what a horrible death might be in store for him, gave himself up to an influential merchant in town who promised to keep his hiding place a secret until the citizens would agree to give him a fair trial. A number of Skagway citizens secretly formed a vigilance committee. They drafted a petition to be sent to the War Department requesting the imposition of martial law. There is an extraordinary condition of affairs existing at near Dyea in Skagway, Alaska, which calls for the prompt attention from the proper authorities. In view of the fact that there is not local civil government in the territory of Alaska, and no one with sufficient authority to enforce the laws of the land, much less prevent crime and disorder, and in view of the large number of the undesirable and criminal class who are now flocking to our community to prey upon the unwary and innocent pilgrim. And in order to have someone with sufficient authority and in sufficient numbers to prevent disorder and blockades on the trails leading to Lakes Lindeman and Bennett, and to protect the property of the citizens of the United States, we the undersigned petition that immediate action be taken by the proper authority. And believing this to be an extraordinary emergency, we believe that martial law should be declared in all this part of Alaska comprising the communities of Dyea and Skagway, and the trails leading there from the international boundary. And that sufficient troops, no less than 300, be immediately dispatched to these points to enforce the laws and preserve order. The Seattle Post-Intelligencer reported that Bartender Faye's supporters, led by Soapy Smith, threatened that if Faye was lynched, Smith's associates and allies would use their guns. Smith stated there were 205 gang members and that there would be shooting if Fay was hanged. Fay was thus allowed to go to Sitka to await trial. At trial, Fay would eventually be acquitted on self-defense grounds. U.S. troops were ordered north. The troops arrived the first week of March. They pitched their tents on the snow and ice outside Skagway, about 1 mile from the center of the business district. Notices were posted March 8th, warning that all gambling rooms and sure thing games must be closed by 1 o'clock the following day. Both companies of troops marched into Skagway on the deadline and enforced the order, closing all saloons and gambling halls. Soapy's faction threatened vengeance. There was another murder on a White Pass trail. Inbound miner H. Bean was shot at close range in what was likely a robbery interrupted by a passerby. A second meeting of the Committee of 101 was held, and another notice posted. Warning. A warning to the Y should be sufficient. All confidence men, bunco, and sure thing men, and all other objectionable characters are notified to leave Skagway and the White Pass Road immediately and to remain away. Failure to comply with this warning will be followed by prompt action. Signed, 101. In his typical fashion, Soapy's faction met the same night, responding with a notice from his committee. Warning, the body of men styling themselves 101 are hereby notified that any overt act committed by them will be promptly met by the law-abiding citizens of Skagway, and each member and his property will be held responsible for any unlawful action on their part, and the Law and Order Society, consisting of 317 citizens, will see that justice is dealt out to its fullest extent, as no blackmailers or vigilantes will be tolerated. Signed, the committee. San Fran Examiner headline, March 16, 1898. Troops rule at Skagway. The recent sinking of the Maine in the Havana-Cuba harbor made petty crime in Skagway yesterday's news. For now, the front page headlines were filled with war stories. Any good con artist knows how to hide behind the stars and stripes, and Soapy Smith was no different. On March 19, 1898, Soapy wrote to President McKinley, offering the services of his newly formed Skagway Military Company, a.k.a. Company A, 1st Regiment of National Guard of Alaska. The men of his company were ready to train and fight in Cuba. Soapy received a reply, an acknowledgement which was signed by the President's secretary. Exaggerating, Soapy convinced some that he received a letter signed by the Secretary of War, Russell Lager, and that Lager had commissioned him, Soapy Smith, as Captain of Volunteers. Historians generally agree that Soapy enthusiastically recruited and trained his new militia, and to demonstrate their prowess, he staged a grand parade on May 1st. Soapy rode out on his dapple gray horse in front of his troops. There was a lot of cheering and a lot of flag waving. On May 28, 1898, a prostitute named Ella D. Wilson had been viciously murdered in her bed. The motive, likely robbery. Soapy's Marshal Taylor took charge of the investigation, pretty much guaranteeing that nothing would be done about it. The men returning from the Klondike also had trouble lying in wait, courtesy of the Smith gang. Ed Long was an unemployed Tacoma accountant who headed north and got lucky. Long was returning from the Klondike when he was spotted by someone in Smith's gang. The gang member asked him to deliver a letter addressed to one Y.M. Hopkins, care of Jess Smith's parlor. The carrying of the letter, of course, made Long the obvious mark. Upon arrival with the letter, Long was invited to the bar, ostensibly to enjoy a round of drinks and thanks for the delivery. It did not take long before Lung was surrounded by Hopkins' friends who refused to let him leave. Lung quickly realized this was a trap, and he made a desperate but successful dash for the door, escaping to the waterfront. Not all returning miners had to deal with the Smith gang. Another wealthy returning Klondiker, Jim Dehorgian, went through Skagway without any trouble, seeing neither Soapy or any of his henchmen. Dehorgian's comment, "If you don't drink, you don't get robbed or rolled." The successful return of miners like Lung and Dehorgian represented two things to the local Skagway business community. Number one, they were potential customers. And number two, they were news bearers to the outside world regarding Skagway's reputation. Once news of a few prospectors' bad experiences began filtering out, no amount of public relations work by small crooked Skagway newspapers would save Skagway. If potential gold seekers were scared to death of Skagway, Skagway would be ruined. The business community, which had before been callous and submissive, were finally, out of their own self-interest, beginning to fight back. On July 4, Soapy was the Grand Marshal of Skagway's 4th of July parade. Once again, Mr. Smith had ascended. Fate, however, was on its way down from the Klondike. Four days later, a successful prospector named J.D. Stewart returned from the Klondike with nearly $3,000 worth of gold. He would meet up with some of Soapy's men, who offered some civilization to a man who hadn't seen any in a while. The Reverend Bowers enticed J.D. Stewart over to Jeff's parlor by offering a favorable exchange rate for his gold. According to most accounts, Stewart was lured into the backyard in order to see the eagle, and then the usual mugging, fake fight, and the money or valuables' effective disappearance from its rightful owner. Standard modus operandi for the Smith gang. But this time there would be an outcome a great deal different than what they were used to. Stewart, cheated out of his hard-dug gold, complained to Marshal Taylor. When after some hours, Stewart correctly surmised that Marshal Taylor was a Smith gang ally, Stewart began frantically telling the story to anyone who would listen, and word spread quickly to some of the prominent citizens who were actively involved with the Vigilance Committee. These citizens had had enough. They sought out Soapy Smith and they demanded the gold's return. Smith stalled for time, promising to return the gold. The newspaper man who was in Soapy's pocket turned on him and soon thereafter wrote this account. During the earlier part of the excitement, Smith partially promised several men, including this writer, that in case there was no roar made in the papers, the gold would be returned by 4 o'clock, and that his influence would be used to prevent his men from interfering with returning Klondikers in the future. The promise was not kept, however, nor was the gold returned. On the contrary, Smith began to drink heavily and talk in a rash, defiant manner. When told by a news representative that unless the gold was returned, there would be trouble, Smith replied, "By God, trouble is what I'm looking for." The evening of July 7th, the same day that J.D. Stewart arrived in Skagway with his poke of gold, a load of choice liquor came in on one of the steamers and was picked up late that night by one of the distributors of spirits for the area. As was practice in those days, arrangements had been made for the customs officers to be looking the other way when the load left the dock. Soapy's men, having received a tip on the shipment, posed as customs officers and laid in wait for the load as it came off the dock. They hijacked the liquor. As the shipment had been brought ashore illegally in the first place, there was no resistance from the teamster when they stopped the wagon and let him escape, rather than face arrest. The load was taken to the back of Jeff's place, where it was unloaded, and the team of horses turned loose. Soapy spent most of the next day making rounds of the saloons to which his followers had sold the haul. Although he rarely drank, Smith was more than willing to buy a round for the boys at each of the saloons, and he partook freely in the celebrations, accounting for his intoxicated condition later in the day. Soapy's brain was afire with liquor, which was not his style. He was in the exact mood for trouble. Soapy Some of the merchants were interested in J.D. Stewart's story because he had ordered some suits, and now, with the loss of the gold, he was unable to pay for those suits. They felt this was money out of their own pockets. Judge Selbreed called Smith to his hotel room, ordering him to return the gold by 6 p.m., stating that warrants would be issued for all concerned, including Smith, should he not comply. Soapy was most unhappy, and he returned to Jeff's place. When Soapy Smith learned of the second meeting, he left his saloon for the dock shortly before 9 p.m. He had received a note from Billy Supportis, who had covered the previous vigilante meetings as a reporter, stating, "The crowd is angry. If you want to do anything, do it quick." Confident that once again he could bluff his way out of trouble as he had in the past, Smith left the saloon with his trusty Winchester over his arm, expressing his confidence. "I'll drive the bastards into the bay." He moved along Holly Street to State, which ran parallel to Broadway. And then he turned south toward the waterfront, muttering that he would teach these damn sons of bitches a lesson. "Chase yourselves home to bed," Soapy Smith shouted to some bystanders, swinging his rifle off his shoulder and waving like a fly swatter. The crowd hung back but did not disperse. A few of his followers, sensing danger, had already fled to the hills. One of the last to talk with Soapy Smith on the way to the dock was John Clancy, Smith's erstwhile saloon partner, who was out for a walk with his wife and six-year-old son. As Smith passed them, Clancy tried to dissuade him from going to the wharf, but Smith was in no mood for chatter. Clancy was unable to convince Smith to change his mind, and Smith said, "Johnny, you better leave me alone," and Smith urged them to return home. "All right," Clancy said, "if you want to get killed, go ahead." As they stepped aside to let Soapy pass, Ms. Clancy began to cry. Harriet Pullen was out with her son Royal, looking for her other son Dan, who was 12 years old, and who she feared might wander down to the wharf and get caught up in the trouble. "As I approached the wharf, Soapy passed me carrying his Winchester, remarking to himself, 'I'm going to fix them.'" Soapy Smith arrived at the dock, and he was met by four men, the two important ones being Frank Reid and Jesse Murphy. Soapy and Frank Reid were the initial combatants as an altercation began. Reid made a motion. "My God, don't shoot!" Soapy cried out. Frank Reid tried killing Soapy right then and there, but his gun misfired. Soapy Smith shot Frank Reid in the groin, a shot that eventually would prove fatal. Reid then fired three shots at Soapy, one of them hitting him in the leg. The lesser-known history takes over here. It's Jesse Murphy who then wrests Soapy's rifle from him and shoots Soapy smack dab in the middle of his heart, pretty much killing Soapy Smith instantly. Now, I know the more popular version has Frank Reid doing all the shooting that did Soapy Smith in, but what is probably the more reliable history has Reid doing the shooting that did the wounding. But it is likely that Jesse Murphy is the fella who did the shooting that did the killing of Soapy Smith. This version where Jesse Murphy did the killing was documented in a number of places fairly early on. It seems that official credit was given to Reid in order to put the matter to rest, so to speak, so that the town could move on. It was a way of avoiding martial law. People are free to believe whichever version they choose, I guess, and to an extent it does not matter all that much. In the end, Soapy Smith was dead, and Frank Reid was mortally wounded. According to the widow Pullen, a party of men picked Reid up and hurried him to the hospital, and before I could realize what happened, my son Royal and I were alone with the dead outlaw. One or two men passed on. One man in particular, kicking Soapy Smith's corpse as he passed. Royal looked the dead bandit in the face. "Why, Mama, that is the man that bought all us kids candy. And now he's dead." After carrying Reid to the hospital and Soapy Smith to the morgue, Skagway citizens reconvened to organize a response and an investigation. Soapy's marshal, Marshal Taylor, was passed over, and U.S. Commissioner C.A. Selbreed swore in John M. Tanner as deputy marshal. Selbreed deputized 25 others to assist Tanner, and the roundup of the Smith gang had begun. It was probable that many of the gang members had already fled town, even before the fateful showdown at Juno Wolf. Not all gang members were able to escape. The roundup had begun. Old Man Tripp was captured on July 10th after hunger drove him back into town. Tripp remarked, "I'd rather be hung on a full stomach than die of starvation in the goddamn mountains." Another colorful quote emerges from the gang's brief time on the run in the Alaskan wilderness. On Saturday night, the Reverend Bowers shook Old Man Tripp away, crying, "Wake up, wake up, they are coming to hang us." Tripp's reply, "For God's sakes, let me alone. We should have been hanged 20 years ago." The Reverend Bowers, Slim Jim Foster, and Wilder were captured around 8 o'clock that same evening when they walked into a clearing upon the staked-out wagon road north of the cemetery. The prisoners were then housed at the Burkhart Hotel. It did not take long until a large mob gathered in front of the hotel. The mob was intent on lynching the prisoners and wanted Stewart's gold returned. At 3 in the morning, with news of soldiers coming from Dyea, the mob rushed the hotel. Slim Jim Foster made the leap from the second floor window and fled with the mob shooting at him. He was not injured by the fall nor by the bullets, but instead was recaptured a few blocks later. Deputy Marshal Tanner stepped in and prevented a lynch. Frank Reid lingered in the hospital for days, at times rallying and giving the town some hope, but in the end, he died of his injuries and infection. Soapy's funeral was a fairly lonely affair, mainly attended by his lawyers and an apparent mistress. The attending minister read this verse in the Book of Proverbs: "The way of the transgressor is hard." Frank Reid's funeral some days later was attended by hundreds of people. The whole town closed down to observe Reid's passing. Captain Billy Moore sued everyone in sight regarding the actions which resulted in the loss of his land. Eventually, he settled the case for at least $100,000. Less than the value of the land, but far more than the nothing the claim jumpers and Frank Reid had initially offered him. Harriet Pullen put it this way at the end of the small booklet she wrote about the Soapy Smith in Skagway Saga: "Thus ends our story of Jefferson Randolph Smith, Soapy Smith, a story of a man taking the wrong trail, dying as he had lived, defying law and order. The legend lives on."
Bye.